And José Manuel told you I will talk about chaperone mediated autophagy and a little bit the background about this pathway and what we were doing about neurodegeneration, which is TDP involved. Some metabolic process with the hypothalamic neurons. And I'm not going to present results on this part, but the project that we are going just starting, okay? So autophagy involves different pathways, you know, that all of them reach the lysosome to degrade different cellular material. In general, there are three principal pathways. The pathway called macroautophagy, that is the pathway that maybe you know very well, that is also called autophagy, involves the formation of a membrane called a vesicle called autophagosome, and then fused with the lysosome. The other pathway is called macroautophagy, in which is involved the MVBs, molecular multivesicular bodies, that fuse also with the lysosome. And these two pathways are, let's say, not specific. Okay, but there is another pathway that is the pathway that we are studying, called chaperone mediated autophagy, that degrades only proteins. Okay, doesn't degrade organelles like mitochondria or reticular endoplasmic like do macroautophagy or microautophagy. And this pathway works by two principal elements. One is the chaperone HSC70, and the other is the protein LIMP2A, the specific isoform A, because there are three isoforms, A, B, C, but the only one that is working in chaperone is the A. And the proteins that are degraded by this pathway contain this motif or this leitmotif called for us K-FRQ. Okay, this motif is recognized by the chaperone that form a complex, and the chaperone takes the protein that cross around this kind of pore that form the LAMP2A protein. So, okay, just a little bit more specific about the macroautophagy, that you know is a pathway that is regulated by mTOR, that is activated with low energy, that form this membrane that come from the endoplasmic reticulum of different other sources, membrane sources, that form the autophagosome. And macroautophagy, as I told you, can degrade protein aggregates, mitochondria, or endoplasmic reticulum through the autophagosome that fuses with the lysosome. Regarding coming back to chaperone, this is regulated for another molecular factors, another chaperones that and some phosphatases and kinases or other GTP binding proteins, and all these factors regulate the formation of the LAMP2A complex. That this is the principal step regulating the chaperone mediated autophagy. LAMP2A can be found in dimers, but when it's oligomerized, this this channel is able to introduce the protein to be degraded. So this is one of the more important steps in the process. How many proteins can degrade this pathway? A lot of protein. Okay. If you look at the whole protein, human protein, you can find that in general, around 75% of the protein can be degraded or putatively degraded by CMA. And if you divide the Kafir-Q-like domains in different subtypes, you can find canonical ones, which are bound directly by the chaperone, but there are another motif that can be formed by phosphorylation or acetylation according to different modification that the motif can be can have. And the different proteins can have one or more Kafir-Q domains. So about the functions and the activity of CMA, it has been found to regulate different physiological processes like glycolysis, lipolysis, and also in different diseases like cancer, neurodegeneration. I will talk about a little bit more about this. Immunity in the presentation of T cells and APC cells. And you must know that CMA activity, every cell has a basal activity of CMA, but it can be activated by different stimuli like starvation, oxidative stress, and DNA damage, hypoxia. And also, it has been found that the age or highlighted contents or protein aggregation can inhibit this pathway, and the cell goes in a state that can be dangerous for the cell. So, in this presentation, I will talk about two articles that we have published. One of them about the involves TDP aggregation. That is a topic that I took from here. As you know, TDP is involved in amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. I'm not going to enter in details on this part. And I will show you how CMA can control the degradation of TDP43 and how the aggregates can affect the CMA activity. And also, I will show you a little bit the process in which CMA could be involved in the outgrowth of axon, motor neuron axon. This is a part that we are working on, and it's unpublished. And another work that I told you is the effect that some fatty acids can have on autophagy and on CMA, and how can affect the function of hypothalamic neurons. And the last part is just a background part. I'm not going to show you a result about this. I will show you the new project that we are going or we are preparing regarding oral processes like odontoblast differentiation and function. So about CMA and neurodegeneration, Samba Brown, CMA has been found to be involved in Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, and Huntington's disease. And why? Because different proteins involved in this neurodegenerative disease are CMA suppressed. And the activity of CMA has been involved in the process of these diseases in different in vitro and in vivo models. And also in patients, it has been found that the protein LAMP2A is downregulated in some diseases. So In general, the hypothesis is that the activity of CMAs go down with age, and of course, the proteins, the substrate protein of CMAs are not more degraded by the pathway and accumulate. Also, the accumulation of this protein, specifically the aggregates, can block the pathway because CMA is not able to degrade aggregates, okay, like macroautophagy do. These aggregates instead stack the LAMP2A channel and affect the lysosome. The other is some work found that the TDP has a Caffer2-like domains, but the fact that TDP was a CMA substrate doesn't was proved yet. So this is that we did in our work, and at the moment nothing was known about TDP in motor neurons cells. So we make some questions about this. Is TDP43 a CMA substrate? Can TDP aggregates impact the CMA activity? Can CMA impact motor neuron axon development? And if CMAs regulate, for example, neurofilament subunit protein levels, I will let you know how we ask this question. So to understand if TDP was a CMA substrate, what you can do is isolate CMA positive lysosomes. You can do it from tissue or from cells. There are different well performed protocols, and you can isolate lysosomes which has less or more CMA activity, and with these lysosomes in vitro, you can test different proteins, the degradation of different proteins, and you can test if these proteins are CMA substrate. So we did it with the recombinant TDP43, and by incubating the lysosome with protease inhibitors. So you can see here that when you incubate the lysosomes with the proteases, TDP is not degraded, but when you leave the lysosome without inhibitors, TDP is degraded. And also, because this is a competitive assay, if you incubate these lysosomes with the GRPDH, which is a classic CMA substrate, it's a very well-known substrate, you can see here you block, if this is the degradation of TDP by CMA in this dot, if you incubate with GRPDH, you block the degradation of TDP. So you can say that this is a specific degradation, and that TDP is entering really in the lysosome. Next, we asked if maybe TDP is in brain lysosomes, and for this we isolated CMA positive lysosome from the whole brain, and we look at the different CMA proteins like LAMP2A and HSC70 and GRPDH. And as you can see here, TDP is found principally in the CMA positive lysosomes. That is for us telling that is something that is telling that TDP in vivo can be degraded, or maybe is being degraded by CMA. Next, We wanted to know if the TDP aggregation affects the activity of CMA, and we did it by using a server model that we created here in the Emanuele's lab, the Prof. Barale labs. And these cell lines express TDP, overexpress TDP wild type in the nucleus, or overexpress an aggregated form of TDP43, or this is just the basal lane. And what we did was to understand, for example, if the knocking down of CMA, the knocking down of the activity of CMA by doing SI of LAN2A affected the level of wild-type TDP or the aggregated form. And we observed a little bit increase in the wild-type form, and also in the aggregated form when we block the CMA activity. We didn't see this effect in the endogenous one. Maybe it's because here the basal level of TDP are principally in the nucleus, and the activity of CMA is performed principally in the cytoplasm. Okay, this is the reason why we didn't see the endogenous TDP increase by the blocking of CMA. Then we asked if these TDP were in the lysosomes, in the CMA lysosomes of these cells, and we found it in the lysosomes, the overexpressed TDP and the endogenous one. So this result confirmed us that TDP is being degraded in the lysosomes. And a surprise for us, we also found TDP aggregated form in the lysosome, but discussing with the reviewers, we suspect that these are not aggregate, but are just a monomer forms of this aggregated form of TDP43. So these results confirm us that the TDP in these cells was entering also in the lysosomes. Then we look at the activity of CMA by looking at the expression of the CMA components when we overexpress the wild type protein or the protein that aggregates. And we surprisingly found that the aggregate form of TDP43 increase the levels of LAMP2A and the levels of HSC70, indicating that this pathway is responding to the aggregation or an aggregation condition of TDP43. This was specific for CMA because when we made the same with macroautophagy markers like P62, that is a protein that is degraded by macroautophagy when macroautophagy is activated, or vice versa, and LC3, that is the component of the pathway, as I showed you before, we didn't see differences in these markers, in these macroautophagy markers, when we overexpress the wild type or the endogenous one, the wild type, or the aggregated form of TDP43. So this was indicating that somehow CMA is responding to the TDP aggregation and at least in this model, but not macroautophagy. Then we did another controls and we look at the interaction between the aggregating prone form of TDP with HSC70 and also the other forms. And we observe a big interaction between the aggregating form of TDP with HSC70, indicating that this form of TDP is being recognized by the pathway by the chaperone. Also, we observe a little bit of interaction with the overexpressed form of the wild type overexpressed form, and with the endogenous one, at least with this method, we didn't see a lot of interaction with the HSC70, even if the IP was showing. Okay, then when we were interested to know if the aggregation of TDP somehow was inducing lysosomal damage in CMA lysosomes, because as I told you, different proteins that aggregate are known to inhibit CMA and to perform damage in the lysosome. And for this, we use this galactin-3 assay. Galactin-3, when the lysosomes are damaged, they go to the lysosomes and bind the lysosomes, and you can make a readout of the lysosome damage with galactin-3. And for example, in green you have here galactin-3. In red you have LAMP2A, so to mark the CMA lysosomes. And when you perform a lysosome damage with a kind of compound, you can have galactin recognizing the lysosomes, specifically these LAMP2A lysosomes. And interestingly, when you overexpress the aggregate form of TDP, you also found galactin recognizing the LAMP2A lysosomes, indicating that the overexpression of the TDP of the aggregated form of TDP induce CMA lysosome damage. Okay, so this third part, we prove that TDP is a CMA substrate. So if CMA somehow is blocked in some disease, it can affect the aggregation of the TDP43. And also, we prove that once the aggregates are formed, they can block the activity of TDP of CMA, and it can be it can do a damage loop for the cells. Another part that I would like to tell you is about the role of CMA in motor neurons. Okay, and for this, okay, we work with the NSCC 34 motor neurons, which they differentiate and develop axons or neurons at 6 or 8 days of low level of FBS. And to test the effect of the aggregation of TDP, we work with a model in collaboration with Dr. Angelo Poletti, Università di Studi di Milano, which is a classical model of TDP aggregation, which include the 25 kilodalton fragments. Okay, And we work with this model to test the activity of CMA in these motor neurons. First, what we observed was that by inducing these aggregates in the motor neurons, the levels of GAPDH are high in this condition, so indicating that the activity of CMA can be downregulated by the expression of this kind of aggregate, TDP aggregate in these motor neurons. The other thing that we observe is that if we differentiate these motor neurons, they somehow develop new axons or neurons a little bit early that the motor neurons that are not expressing the aggregates. So, but then when you still differentiate them, you can see a collapse in the axons by looking, for example, at the neurofilament subunit, and you can see the differences. You here have the motor neurons at the 3 days of differentiation, but at 6 days of differentiation, these axons are somehow collapsed with accumulation of a neurofilament subunit. So we look at the levels of the neurofilament in the condition of the expression of the TDP aggregates, and we observe that these neurofilaments are levels are also increased. So we saw that somehow these TDP aggregates are blocking the CMA activity, as you can see by increasing the level of GAPDH, and also by increasing the level of the neurofilament subunit. And this increase in the neurofilament subunit could maybe is the reason why we have these changes in the development of the axon of the neuron or the neural. So we look at the amino acid sequences of the different neurofilament subunits, and we found different CAFRQ like domains in this subunit. So we see that this neurofilament can be CMA substrate, and what we made was to perform a cell line with an SH RNA of LAN2A, and we observe at the level of the neurofilament subunit H, and we observe an increase in this neurofilament subunit by blocking CMA. So we think that this subunit and the other ones are CMA substrate, and a TDP aggregation in this substrate in a TDP aggregation can affect CMA activity, and this affection in the CMA activity can have a dangerous effect on the neurofilament homeostasis. And then what we observed was that the cells that the motor neurons that start to form axons, they have a less activity of CMA, because something that I didn't tell you is that when CMA is active, the lysosome localized in a perinuclear region, but this is something that is very well known, But when the CMA is has less activity, this lysosome goes around the cells. So we found that the cells that are not inducing or developing axons have high CMA activity, and this this activity localized very well with the neurofilament. But the cells that start to develop axons seems to have low CMA activity. So what we made was look at the motor neurons with the NSH of LAMP2A, that these cells have low CMA activity, and as you can see here, they start to develop axons very, very, very early, even if you put them at 10% FDS, that they that is a condition in which they has not develop axons. So what the hypothesis that we are thinking is that the low CMA activity is necessary for the development of this axon in these motor neurons, or at least in this model, maybe because there is a regulation of the neurofilament through the activity of CMA. So this is a project that we are working on. Okay, just some conclusion of this part. TDP seems to be a substrate of CMA in vitro and in vivo. CMA TDP aggregates activate somehow CMA, but TDP also can affect the CMA activity by blocking the lysosome activity and lysosome trafficking. That this is a result that I didn't show. And ongoing experiments say that CMA activity seems regulate the axon outgrowth in motor neurons, and that also TDP aggregate seems to inhibit CMA activity, and that TDP aggregates inhibition could alter the neurofilament subunit homeostasis and maybe cause neurox collapse. This is the working model that we are thinking about this part. The second part of the talk, and I will go a little bit past, is about the metabolic processes, and we work with hypothalamic neurons, and we study CMA in this context because it is well known that saturated fatty acid block accumulate in the hypothalamus, that this fatty acid inhibit macroautophagy, that pumps in neurons, that regulates the appetite, the inhibition of macroautophagy in these neurons induce obesity. We know also that CMA's activity is inhibited by fatty acids in liver, but we didn't know anything about the role of CMA in this ponce in the context of metabolic processes. So we made some question: if CMA activity is inhibited by fatty acid in Pompe neurons, which can be the mechanism of such inhibition, and which kind of CMA substrate can be affected if CMA activity is modified in these neurons, hypothalamic neurons. And for this, we evaluated the CMA components. We evaluated the CMA activity. Also, we made a proteomics by isolating lysosome. We made the proteomics from the isolated lysosomes, and we identified from these proteomics the CAFER2 the proteins containing buffer-Q motifs, and we made an analysis of the principal proteins that were changed. So what we found was that the incubation of fatty acid of in these pump cell-like neurons downregulates the protein levels of LAMP2A, the total protein levels, and also downregulate the lysosomal protein levels. The mechanisms by doing this, we are studying it. We don't know how the fatty acid downregulate the protein level of LAMP2A, and we don't know if there is a problem in the transport of LAMP2A that is affecting the its localization in the lysosome. Also, we evaluated the activity of CMA, and we did it by looking at the level of GPDH. If you can see here, when you stimulate CMA, you have a degradation of GPDH, but when you incubate the cell with palmitic or stearic acid, you block this degradation, so indicating that this fatty acid block CMA. We did it also by a specific protein which contain a CAFER-Q that you can follow the activity by fluorescence. When you activate CMAs, you can count this lysosome containing this fluorophore. But when you incubate the cells with palmitic or stearic acid, you can see an inhibition of CMA. So the incubation of fatty acid in these cells block or inhibit the CMA activity. Then we isolated lysosomes and we performed a SILAC and a protein identification. We made an analysis of the CAFER-Q of the protein containing CAFER-Q, and we observed that around the more than 50% of the protein were downregulated in the conditions when you incubate with this fatty acid, so indicating that the pathway is being inhibited by this incubation. And then we analyze the kind of protein or the total protein that contain CAFER-Q-like domain from the whole pool of protein, and we found that around 80% or 90% of the protein can be CMA substrate. And which are the principal proteins that are being modified by palmitic and stearic acid in these cells? The upregulated proteins by both fatty acids are principally proteins involved in transport, in vesicle transport, but the proteins that are downregulated are principally mitochondrial proteins. So these proteins are not entering in the lysosome for degradation. Then we look a little bit at the insulin pathway, because we observe that there are some proteins that are being downregulating here, and we observe that the block of CMA by doing downregulation of LAMP2A affect the response. The response of these cells to the insulin stimulation, and the same we found if the cells were incubated with palmitic and stearic acid. So the conclusions here are that if fatty acid accumulate in the hypothalamus, these fatty acids can affect San hipotalamic cell, in this case, in this model, POMC cells that are inhibiting the appetite. And this accumulation of these fatty acids can block CMA. And if CMA is involved or is necessary for the insulin response, so the accumulation of these fatty acids through CMA can block insulin response. Okay, I will skip this conclusion just to tell you about the last part of the presentation, that this, as I told you, is a project that we have just started. And what we are going to do is to study CMA in the context of odontoblast differentiation and dentin formation. As you know, I'm in the Faculty of Dentistry. So the background that we have here is the nothing is known about the role of CMA in odontoblast differentiation. There is nothing. That CMA has been reported to be necessary for the trigger on differentiation and other pluripotent cells, and some proteins inhibiting odontoblast differentiation are CMA, are putative CMA substrates. So the question that we made was, which is the status of the CMA activity along the odontoblast differentiation process? Is CMA activity necessary for odontoblast differentiation process, in which can be the putative CMA protein substrate that regulate odontoblast differentiation? So odontoblasts are stem cells, differentiate from stem cells, from the mesenchymal stem cells. And the nice is that they, once differentiated, they form the dentin. But there is a population of the odontoblast that remains undifferentiated. And this undifferentiated odontoblast have the function of produce new dentin when the tooth is damaged, for example, for a carious lesion. Okay, so in general, odontoblasts are a very well polarized cells when they arrive to the whole differentiation process, and these very well polarized cells form these dentin tubules in the tooth, and these dentin tubules are a like of sensory sensory are the function of sense different stimuli or in the tooth. Odontoblast have different functions, as I told you: the formation of dentin during the tooth development, the dentin maintenance during tooth lifespans, protect the dental pulp, which is the live part of the tooth, produce new dentin in response to tooth damage, for example, as I told you, in caries lesion, and trigger immunological alert against tooth damage and sense temperature and mechanical stimuli. Here, you can see a caries lesion. These are this is dentin formed by a normal odontoblast, and here you can see dead odontoblast because of this caries lesion. Then, when this odontoblast die, the stem cells from the pool start to differentiate to new odontoblast and start to perform new dentin to protect protect the pool. That's why it's important to study the differentiation process in these stem cells from the dental pool, because it has a lot of application to protect the pool in carious lesion, or to keep alive the tooth. Okay, and that's why we are interested in to study CMA in odontoblast, and regarding the background between autophagy and odontoblast, the principal background is known about autophagy, macroautophagy. Which is has been found to be accumulated in all odontoblasts, has been found to be important for odontoblast differentiation and also for dentin formation. But nothing is known about CMA and odontoblast. The only two work that connect the role of CMA with differentiation of pluripotent cells are two recent works in which they have found that the CMA activity need to have a peak for the differentiation of these cells, and then the activity of CMAs goes down along the differentiation process. To study possible CMA substrate during the odontoblast differentiation, we have found that this isocitrate dehydrogenases enzymes can be CMA substrate because these enzymes regulate the levels of alpha ketoglutarate. And the level of alpha ketoglutarate need to be down for the differentiation of these other stem cells. So we hypothesize that CMA can be involved in the differentiation of these odontoblasts by regulating these enzymes, or by regulating other proteins that are involved in the inhibition of the odontoblast differentiation. So what we are doing now is isolating human dental pluripotent cells to study this differentiation. We are evaluating the CMA activity during the differentiation of these dental stem dental pool stem cells. We are preparing dental pool stem cells with high semi activity by upregulating LAMP2A or by downregulating it. And we are evaluating different putative substrates, as I showed you before. And this just this is a result in of recent isolated dental stem cells from the pool and to work with the in this project. So this is the presentation. Just I leave you here some pictures of my other passion, that is ultra running. Recently I went in the I was in the Mont Blanc running the UTMB 100 kilometers here Chamonix with the Mont Blanc. This is another part of the Mont Blanc in Formayer. Some pictures of Santiago, Chile, when I live. Some pictures of my training this winter and also here. And thank you very much for the attention.